I'm Russell Ferguson. I'm the chair of the art department at UCLA. Welcome to tonight's lecture, which is by our Department of Art Art Council Chair, Runa Islam. And the lecture is made possible through the generous support of the UCLA Art Council. And again, thanks to the Hammer for hosting it in this beautiful theater. Runa Islam creates film and video installations. There are overlapping layers of narratives, and she explores a variety of issues in her work, including truth and fiction, subjectivity and authorship. She was born in Dhaka, Bangladesh, and she now lives in London. Her works have been shown in numerous exhibitions around the world, including here at the Hammer Museum in 2005. Also including MUMOK in Vienna, the Hirshhorn in Washington, the Walker in Minneapolis. She's shown in the Seville Biennale and the Venice Biennale. And last year she was a nominee for the Turner Prize in Britain. And as I said, she's the UCLA Art Council Chair for 2008-2009. So please join me in welcoming Runa Islam.
Thank you, Russell. Thanks also to UCLA Department for having me as the Art Council Chair. And also, it's really nice to come back to the Hammer nearly 4 years after having spoken in a theatre that didn't look very much like this. So I feel like I've kind of been upgraded, which is great. I wanted to sort of arrange the lecture today in a way that I sort of could be generous in showing you a lot of different works, but at the same time sort of, try to get inside a couple of works. So this evening I was going to start way back in the 20th century, in 1996, where I made a work which I feel was like sort of a turning point work for me, like a sort of crystallizing point, which is something probably, as most of you are students here, is quite an sort of, you know, it's a moment to be remembered, actually, where you feel like all that struggle and everything you've been trying to talk about in the kind of huge, sense of the context of everything around you, everything you know, everything you've learned, and how do you say anything in the midst of all that. So if I could start with my keynote presentation, which I spent the whole day trying to get to grips with. I've got a slide of what's kind of like a box of slides. And these are actually real slides. And what you see is the accumulation of 1 year's work. And this was almost like a little gesture of trying to think of how do you use even, a gesture, a brushstroke, a pencil, a pen. I was using a camera and trying to think of how to record something about me or myself, but at the same time I was also interested in this idea of how the camera has the ability to put something in the center of a frame, and essentially I was kind of making a diary of something I felt had a relationship to me. It was the view outside my window, and in fact it was a tree under which piles of rubbish kind of were left every day, and it infuriated me for a long time. But then I sort of started to look at it as a still life, and over 1 year, I actually photographed it every day at 12 midnight and 12 midday. If I wasn't there, just to go back, I left a black slide. And it was kind of interesting, like 12 midday, I can't remember the date exactly, but say somebody was, a little kid was running past. someone threw flowers away. You could tell when it was Christmas because there was like a lot of Christmas trees out there. And this kind of framing shows, I think it almost belies something that's continued through the last 10, 12, 15 years actually of work, where I've always been interested in looking at something that's kind of not really in our eye line, but sort of off center or peripheral. I'm just going to jump to another work, 1997. I was using the first camera that I could say I used in terms of moving images was not anything really digital, but a Super 8 camera. And I also felt that with it, I was trying to catch little fleeting glimpses of things around me, and also the 3-minute cartridges that you could get in Super 8 for Super 8 cameras were somehow limiting as well, so you could only just catch something. And this idea of how that little moment that wouldn't exist without your gaze on it could be sort of, you know, caught or imprisoned. These are just sort of stills put together, so it's nothing to do with the way it's projected. They're just images of the stills of these works. All relate to one work that's called Five Super 8 Portraits, and each was a portrait of somebody or something around me, and there was five of them, hence the number. And the idea of portraiture was kind of interesting. I would even say the first piece I showed you, which was called Refuge, these two words that you use for rubbish, as a kind of portrait. Just a funny little thing I found when I was searching images from like 10, 15 years ago. Super 8 film. I arrived in Venice and found a little girl dressed in a red coat, which was very funny for me. And this sort of like links back to later ideas where that sort of like the iconic universal collective images that already pervade sort of injected into my work. An installation in a group show, collaborations that I was doing early on. 1997, five films, all with the same soundtrack that I'd taken off a film, and then subjected five people to sit there and listen to that work. And it was a George Romero film called Martin, which kind of related to this identity of a boy on the cusp of adulthood, deemed as a kind of vampire. And that thematic was sort of sewn into this exhibition at large. And I attended to that with things like this black ball, which worked like an eclipse and overshadowed other people's works in a way, sort of like a sort of vampiric act. The assault on these five people having to listen to this introduction, which was actually very, very intense, where someone's killed and you hear a lot of screaming, and each person reacts to it differently. So just like a kind of strange, disturbing portrait. In that piece also, a kind of dark room that looked like a monolith or an obelisk, but also a little bit like a little vampire's room, the red of a dark room relating to a kind of leap of imagination. That in a way that photography is a vampiric act, that you catch things and you keep them and you collect them, and a dark room that functioned and you could develop pre-exposed images. So that was kind of interesting because that work, Martin, had like so many different works in it that I sort of felt I hadn't completely worked out what it is I wanted to say. And likewise with the Super 8 portraits, it seemed that the power of the camera itself was much stronger than my intentions. That, say, for example, Super 8 film, if you even use it today, it has a very, very sort of nostalgic texture and quality, and then that itself was sort of the text, and whatever I put in it started to have a kind of beautiful, grainy, nostalgic portrait. Martin seemed to try to do many things and everything at the same time. But I do like this idea of looking back at this work, so I just thought I'd share it with you because it sort of probably doesn't look anything like the stuff that you know of my work. But for example, for me, the shadow is very important in relation to photography, light and shadow. This is a picture from a series called Shadows, starting off again looking at the street as a sort of peripheral point of view. I'm trying to take a photograph of a little whirlwind of leaves, but catching my own shadow in the picture and then sort of taking that as a starting point, printing them really large so that the shadow of my body would be the same size as me. So you kind of looked at, you looked straight at this image that should be on the floor, but it sort of then inverts your relationship to it. And funny enough, just the shadow on the side is actually my Super 8 camera that I used to carry with me absolutely everywhere, snatching little bits of life as it happened. But funny enough, nowadays I hardly carry anything, so it's interesting how there is a different kind of desire at a different age, especially when you want to start to contribute and you feel you don't differentiate as much. Whereas now I sort of think I differentiate maybe too much. And then there's so many artworks that I don't make that could be made in a snapshot. Again, street scenes, I can identify where I was. That's Amsterdam, that's Paris, that's Berlin. But essentially banal, everyday images. And the sort of subject matter that I'm looking at, you know, sort of eclipsed. This is a work from 1998, and this was, for me, a second kind of crystallization point. I did give a seminar about these works to some of the undergrads, so I apologize if I repeat myself. What you see here is also what I would call a shadow. And the idea of a shadow on a neck as some light and shadow on sensitive material. And this was, these are sort of film strips. This is actually the still. It's the third 16mm film I made, and I started to use 16mm film because when I was using Super 8 films, I sort of got overly precious about the fact that once you recorded on this material, it was the real indexical kind of, it was an original, unique object. And I sort of got very precious about it. And I also had to transfer it to video, and I didn't feel that it was quite relating to these ideas of film as something that really captures like a thumbprint, like an index. So I saw that the negative that you got from a 16mm film was kind of itself, it had this sort of quality. I wanted to do something with it. So I actually made a film where I only showed the negative, and it was quite interesting because when I asked to only make this negative, the lab gave me back a positive and didn't really understand why I wanted to have the negative. And the idea was, I mean, this is like about times 500. It's a film that's screened really small, like as if you just had a sort of aura apparition of something life-size, again, like a kind of imprint, one-to-one of a girl's face. No reason why it was a girl, or it's not me. It was somebody who I could use as a kind of stand-in. But I did feel that the face and the close-up has had a kind of real anchor, or sort of had a ballast in that language of film and cinema, and just something really effective, affective, with an A. And at the same time, this idea of the piece is called Stare Out, Blink, meaning, you know, it's a sort of invitation to stare out this face, who, you know, of an animated, sort of something that sort of stands in for a human presence, but actually it's not, but it's animated. The girl only blinks once. And finally, in the film, there's sort of intervals of white, well, not even white, just blank sort of celluloid, and at these points the screen just gets filled with light, and at the point that you stare at this light, because you've been staring at the face, the light kind of makes you blink yourself, and you're left with this after image. And I like this idea that the eye could be photosensitive and is the first kind of photosensitive material. And I'm just actually not going to over-explain things, and I'm sorry if I sort of jump at points when maybe this seems unfinished, but I wanted to get through quite a lot. This was made in tandem with the piece that you saw, Stare Out Blink. Same girl, different intention. And I purposely used video, digital video, 1997, when Sony had produced these sort of quite sophisticated cameras with three chips and stuff. And so for me, this idea of the actual instrument or the apparatus and the medium and why you use it, and what you use it for is kind of quite important. So the idea of this little sort of incandescent, tiny, fragile film, which is kind of an obsolete medium, and then like a video of the same girl doing something kind of subtly different. She's actually not looking at you, and she just turns around, and at one point she just catches your eye, and it goes to back to the beginning. This piece is called Gaze of Orpheus. Turn, Gaze of Orpheus. And it's kind of tries to claim some ground with the text that Maurice Blanchot wrote about this kind of fatal gaze, that looking itself was a kind of killing. And this sort of went back to this ideas of the vampiric relation of photography, or even that there is a kind of incrementation of time through looking, and everything you look at, every time you blink, you actually lose what you're looking at. So in the first film, there's a kind of immaterial quality of film, that the material nature of the film catches this immaterial existence. So the moment something flashes away, it comes back in your eye. And here, there's a blackout, which we don't catch in this version. And in the moment it flashes to black, you sort of kick in your memory of what you've seen. So two different ways of engaging with what you're essentially sort of, you know, in terms of perception, what you engage with visually, like a kind of phenomena. I was going to show you a film, which actually here it's you see it installed. With the way that these sort of a binary, but I always like to sort of take that term intertextual for this work, this kind of intertextuality that's laying over of different materials, different perspectives, and different ideas, actually, or even ideologies of how each piece, each perspective can sort of embody much more than you think it really does, in just a sense of a point of view shot versus an over-the-shoulder shot, a long shot, a close-up. You see the this kind of quite an incredible movement, you know, like the way a woman sort of approaches. She's eclipsed by the man. She turns around, but there is no sort of single point of view. It's an incredible sort of turn, and I found these images on my on a disc somewhere, and this is actually the film from which I took this sort of template of learning, which I felt quite free to do because the original movement I saw in Martha by Fassbinder, a film that he made with Mikhail Ballhaus, he's this incredible cinematographer who's still around and very much innovating different ways of filming, and he works now with Scorsese, which so it speaks for itself in a way. And I saw this movement, and it was just most incredible dynamic turn that I'd sort of probably since haven't witnessed, in the sense that for its time it just broke the mold, and it actually was an unprecedented kind of cinematographic achievement in the sense that they used a 360-degree track and were able to move the camera and the people in a way that what you sort of were left looking at sort of spun in and out of frame so quickly that you just didn't know what you digested. And I like this idea that I could take it out of Fassbinder's film where he sort of, you know, pictures the woman as this submissive, tragic, masochistic character and the man as somebody who is very, very Fassbinder-likely, sadistic, and there is no kind of redemption because that was kind of a lot of his sort of ideological position in a way. So I like this idea that I could just take something back from cinema for the sake of cinematic. Kind of like exposition or debate or discussion. I just put this slide in to remind myself that this idea of stripping down, of desynchronizing things, and especially like the way the sound just came in after, I wanted it to, but when I made this film, I actually wanted to really take every element apart. So the sound that you didn't hear from the 16mm film, the footsteps of two people walking around each other, was actually sort of detached and put in another room, so you heard this kind of crunching sound that only then came sort of together in your head, so you were the agency of this kind of meaning. And this actually was part of a light box that I put near the work where it wasn't just one. Kind of this idea of copying isn't even something that's so easily achievable. Essentially, I had to take that shot like 15 times, and I took all the outtakes and put them on this light box just to show this sort of relationship to the film and the index and how each movement was unique. I'm skipping over several years now and jumping to a work that I made in 2001, again in this relationship, to continue the conversation of how you can think about double, triple perspectives. And this sort of deals with this sort of dichronical time, which I like to call it, instead of synchronical time, even though the two images that you see were completely synchronized. Working with a sort of dialogic as well, where two perspectives try to sort of jockey for position, and how each position itself can be completely contradictory. But the idea was in this work to really, you know, to try and further investigate why would you put two screens together? Because to some degree, I always kind of question the ease with which some artists, or even not artists, but you know, like how easily now, even on media, you just see effects. This was from 2001, so you know, we're going back 7 years when sort of desktop editing wasn't that common. But now, of course, you can just sort of like create these double images quite with ease. But I like this idea of the double in relation to a kind of figuration of authority. In 2000, I'd worked with a theatre director and sort of had personal experience of this kind of amazing sort of conduct of auteur personas, like, you know, actually being able to almost exert a sort of, I would say, a dominating idea of something into everything else. And essentially, I guess, a director's idea is ultimately the idea that should be sort of tapped through the means with which he wants to express himself or herself. But I sort of found it interesting, this sort of Russian doll effect, that not only was I using two screens, because essentially there's points where the director might say something on one screen, you see the back of his head, and then on the other screen he's like sort of saying the total opposite, and that can actually happen at the same time, that using this type of sort of cancelling out effect, like two screens equally sized could actually just like can't like one plus one could equal one or something. Also things like the head, point planes of focus were very important, how it just focused on the back of this man's head, and how it sort of blocked the actual sort of rehearsal. But also, if I thought of it in terms of a rehearsal of a theatre play, which was actually, of course, a setup, and that for me was quite interesting, this idea of a skeletal sort of working. So in the stage and the props and everything you see it, the idea of just a sort of basic symbolisms coming through. Another sort of triangulation was the idea of the actors being underscored with understudies. So when the actors finally got their lines right, you would sort of hear that understudies also practicing, like there was always this other level. What I don't see here, but what we did see in the clips was also the clapperboard coming in and cutting, which sort of, I guess even then and now more than ever, using that type of, you know, like behind the scenes effect is such a stylistic trope, but at the time I felt it was really able to sort of harness something that would, you know, like again further deal with this sort of breakdown of authority or hierarchy that, you know, the director was being directed by a filmmaker and a filmmaker essentially was an artist. So in the end, like, there was this sort of telescoping effect that the audience was sort of distanced. Same year, I sort of took some of the creative sort of, what would you call it, like fabric that I had left over from Director's Cut, in the sense that I filmed it in one weekend. I was able to use the Royal Court Theatre, which is a really sort of significant theatre in London, because they had what's called a dark day, but they allowed you into this theatre for one day, so it would be like somebody being allowed in here to use it for whatever they wanted. And I had one day to rehearse, and I remember when I made the rehearsals and I had to finish cut, I had to sort of almost look at both at the same time, because at the end of the weekend, I'd finished this project. And I remember thinking how this doubling, using the camera and activities and sort of the idea of, you know, like any film rather than a theatrical kind of performance, you know, the idea of the retakes, how you can just keep going over and over and reproduce these images as doubles, and even if you look at film, how, you know, the frames sort of multiply themselves. So I had this idea and used it to work with an invitation to be in an exhibition which was going to take place simultaneously in Porto and Rotterdam, two European cities, which at the time were European cities of culture, and I sort of found it interesting how these second cities of two major sort of European cities had suddenly come into a limelight and what the hell brought them together. And I use this idea of doubling a story or a script and made what's called, made the film called Parallel, where I used similar, like it was almost like a portrait of a city as if this non, you know, like usually in films, the backdrop locations and backdrops are sort of just there to fill in. But I like this idea that the city itself could be the persona. And I moved through this city through different aspects of any city. So this kind of generic hotel room, in which you see two characters who, in fact, are sort of completely implicated into this film. They go through, they wait for something, they get a message from someone, they get an envelope. There's kind of a slight sort of film noir quality to it. They're followed, they travel over, they escape their follower, they sort of travel over this city as a sort of also a fabric of textures. You know, there's bridges in both these cities, Rotterdam and Porto, both port cities. They've got these kind of iconic structures like the Erasmus Bridge or the Eiffel Bridge. They've also got this sort of like modernism took hold in both cities, also although in Rotterdam not so prevalently because a lot of it was bombed, but Porto not being the capital city could sort of flirt with this idea of a new modern way, like an architecture that was of its of a modern era. And I found these two sites, but actually the site that you see on the right is the museum in Porto, where I had been invited. So I just wanted to layer in something about this place. I use the architecture. Another character enters the sort of scenarios. Not very much actually happens. Like people walk through screens, left to right, you know, exit, sort of, or walk into the frame, sort of Hitchcock style. You know, like everything happens sort of very similarly. But there is something kind of really strange about this kind of synchronicity, like a synchronized swimming or something. But at one point, this idea of the parallel lines themselves converge. And it's kind of at this point, and I've not shown you exactly what happens, but the envelopes are open and there's a reproduced image, like a photograph that sort of brings these two parallel lines together, as if they sort of converge in the distance. And in fact, you've been watching one film all the time. And ultimately, when I present it, it's on one screen. So again, for me, some of these sort of maybe quite like very specialized approaches to maybe being a filmmaker or a video artist, of why, what you show on and how you show it and what scale, the architectural sort of implications of the work, they're all very important to me. And say, for example, if I turn the lights off and just looked at the objects in the room, that's very important that what you see kind of gives you some insight into what's happened. So essentially, when you turn these two screens off, these two projections off, you just get one long cinematic screen. And the gap in the middle for me was about this kind of narrative jumps that you can't ever explain everything in one film. Also, what I didn't explain, or you don't see is, and also in two in the double screens switch over, so this sort of attempt to constantly shift the ground that you kind of feel comfortable with. So as soon as you feel you know the story, so this idea of the parallel cities, you know, Porto, Rotterdam, left, right, it actually switches and it sort of topples your sort of cognitive relationship to it. This film I was going to talk a little bit more about, and I've got three clips which I'm probably going to show you and sort of talk over it a little bit. But 2 years after I made this film, funny enough, again at the invitation, I went to do a residency in the north of England where I wasn't sort of hadn't been before and I wasn't that familiar, and it would seem unusual in such a small country not to sort of get everywhere. But I was asked to go to Newcastle, which I sort of only knew through a film. So in a way, it's like coming to Hollywood and knowing so much of it through its visual sort of signifiers, through this kind of collective history or impressions. And I knew this building, where it looks kind of really unremarkable right now. And funny enough, it's it no longer exists. It's been demolished since. But at the time, it was kind of this sort of infamous building because it was known for its role in the film Get Carter. While I was up there, I also found the maquette, the original architect's maquette, which wasn't sort of as easy as you might think. But it was just also by chance that I found it. What you see here is again this idea of the architectural arrangement of a work. So I'm just leapt forward to to from the very first source material to how it's been displayed. But I made the film's called Scale, and the idea was really this idea, this sense of the jumps between, say, the imaginary to the real to the imaginary to the real is one kind of jump, the fictional, you know, the truth, sort of how you can project something into reality, but at the same time sort of like other jumps, say, between something that you think about an architect's model, something you imagine as a model, itself sort of then being extended into reality, and how these sort of almost cancel each other out. The truth is that this building actually never ever became what it was meant to be, but it was built by an architect called Owen Luder. And this is a kind of rare picture because he's actually inside this unfinished sort of modernist dream in Newcastle, which is kind of an unusual place to make a modernist building. And it's actually to be more specific, it's the very first ever brutalist architecture that appeared in England, and it was meant to be everything from leisure centre to car park to rooftop restaurant. And it was kind of amazing because when I arrived in this room, it looked exactly the same as it had in the film Get Carter, where Michael Caine enters the scene, and exactly from here with it looking the same. They talk about how it was meant to be this restaurant, and that's sort of interesting in both the filmic sort of supposition of it meaning being a restaurant, because ultimately the guy who was going to build the restaurant gets killed because he's like the villain. But in reality, it also never becomes a restaurant because it was there's a whole backstory about the socialist government at the time in Newcastle embezzling most of the money that went into this building, and sort of because brutalism had just arrived in Britain, no one really knew how to build. So they just kind of half the cement and, you know, like just made it look like a brutalist building. But essentially, once it had been finished, it wasn't safe to ever open it up. So sort of some of it still is functioning, but for like 30 years, it's just this building as a ready-made relic or a ruin. This is like a scene which, you know, if I couldn't get the clip, but these sort of conflate the film, what I saw firsthand, is kind of terribly derelict, non-iconic building, just sort of breaking apart with concrete disease, and then like a maquette which had all these visions, you know, that should have been very utopic. And I sort of like this idea of this failed utopia that never turns up. This is sort of, I'm going to really just speed through these. This is a work that I showed at Hammer 3 years ago, but just inherits something of the idea of a site as a stage, and objects, with its architectures, buildings, porcelain, the use value of something, how it can be completely upturned. Again, going back to this idea of how the model of something can be inverted.
If you have a question, we have microphones. Please raise your hand and we will bring one around. We're recording the event, so please wait on the microphone. Thank you.
Hi, I was really struck by your use of the tracking shot in various forms, and, you know, especially in Two, and I loved how you reprised Fassbender because that's one of my favorite scenes.
Right.
You know, and I was just wondering how, you know, if you had any thoughts about how you use tracking shots and the way that it works with or against narrative in your films.
It's interesting because if I could have carried on, there was one film I skipped over called Timelines, where you saw like a kind of tower in the foreground and sort of the blue sky and the sea in the background. There was a period when I really was trying to expose that idea of the apparatus, whether it was the projector behind Blink, as you saw that it was just, you know, projecting a negative. And then later on, in the Fassbinder remake, where I just didn't want to only remake this film as something completely objective, and perhaps a little bit, like a sort of carbon copy. So this idea of bringing in another point of view, which I felt was always like, you know, a kind of dispassionate point of view of cinema in relation to a very engaged and subjective point of view of somebody else looking. And I thought it was interesting that the actor's point of view would then reveal everything. But essentially what I found amazing about that film, which was another kind of crystallizing moment for me, was the camera had turned around on the track, and I used a camera crew to conduct that, because it was a really, really difficult shot to master. And then the actors had carried these cameras, and I realized at the end of it I hadn't touched a single camera, so somehow that these images had been sort of produced by themselves. And later in timelines, I actually used the movement of a cable car to track you through this sort of suspended point of view, and refer to this idea of this impossible point of view of cinema, which often gets aided by things like tracking shots, because they're very embodied in the sense that you don't really move like that, you know. Sort of handheld is so much like a sort of signature of somebody's presence or of bodiliness and emotion, and this kind of dispassionate quality of the tracking shot for me is actually something really at the heart of a lot of my works, because it is a kind of apparatus. In First Day of Spring, it was kind of like the preemption of this interest that I had in the tracking shot or the rails as a sort of writing process, which later I've made like three films where I'm writing with the camera, using a robot, which then it further sort of distances your engagement, not just to be nerdy and further involved into film, but actually to try and see how images or representation can be sort of challenged from the inside out in a way. And essentially also this idea of the tracking shot slowing you down, and also in the Dhaka film that, you know, I was really there doing that. And there's a shot after, I don't know if we can just quickly look at one more image, but how that pseudo-documentary, or not really, it wasn't meant to be a pseudo-documentary, but the idea had been that I paid the rickshaw pullers not to work, and it was kind of interesting that while they were at leisure, the camera was very active, and this tracking shot was actually like a kind of signature of mine, because it meant that it was a purposeful kind of purposeful and very sort of directed intention. Was there a couple more?
In the last response, you mentioned sort of questioning film from the inside out.
Uh-huh.
Can you talk a little bit more about that as sort of a way of being critically engaged with your art and filmmaking?
So just to clarify the relationship of talking about film in relation to art. Critically kind of engaging with film in the art realm, or?
Well, being critically engaged with film from the inside out, as opposed to, you know, maybe oppositionally or just purely deconstruction, because, uh-huh. You know, you talk about how you use a lot of contradiction. You seem to both embrace its enchanting effects, mm-hmm. at the same time as sort of reveal its kind of structure, so.
Because actually I sort of don't feel that it's just a process of deconstruction, because when I made, say, for example, The Garden, there was this whole sort of appraisal of it through deconstruction, and I was kind of stuck with a certain amount of how you have to defer to what people tell you about your work, like once you expose it and you sort of are trapped in the sense that you try to do something, but that wasn't exactly your intent, but somehow 30 people are telling you it's about deconstruction and some people are writing about it. So I sort of really wanted to clarify why it wasn't about deconstruction and how this kind of, it's almost like, you know, like you extinguish one idea and then something else comes up. So in the garden, for example, that revolving around and that sort of echo chamber of the image echoing itself, and how as you actually strip down the process, another kind of layer of cinema builds up, you know, and it's almost as if you can't really quell that approach, you know. So now the sense that we're so used to seeing handheld imagery, or we're sort of really into reality images as a kind of semi-truth, and documentary is always been a sort of pseudo position, so there's never anything such as a real versus a fictional. So for me, that they're real sort of like blades of representation. You know, how did we ever believe in it? What does it stand for? And more recently, one of my robotic films was made in response to being commissioned by a museum to make a work, and I was sort of really thinking about what it means to sort of present your work back in the realm of, you know, spectatorship, where it's already acknowledged that you understand a lot about, you know, you're quite rehearsed about what you're looking at. So, you know, the robot sort of is trapped within this museum that at the time of my filming wasn't being used. I mean, it sort of regards all these different images from the 20th century, essentially what was in the collection, and I asked the curator who invited me to continue curating and sort of curate a show in relation to my interests of this kind of automated image making. What does it mean? And it was interesting because he sort of came out with images from sort of like Richard Hamilton's to Rauschenberg's, Rauschenberg and John's, and Cy Twombly, and, you know, like all these images, and the camera actually just regards these pictures so it never leaves this museum, and this museum itself has opaque glass, transparent glass, but essentially you never actually leave this building. So when you see the outside world, it's through the frame of pictures. So I think it's very interesting, this sort of, you know, to negotiate what it is that we look at, and I guess that's why we're here. And of course, it doesn't disqualify any or qualify my position as an artist, sort of making things mainly with the camera. But to some degree, I do feel that it's such a sort of culprit that most images that we know in the present day are made by these kind of this apparatus.
Would you, when you were talking about your early work having kind of a vampiric quality or subjecting viewers to certain things, would you consider like presenting viewers with like contradictory images, a sort of constructive sadism, maybe?
Well, funny enough, we already mentioned sadism once. So it's a bit of medicine to some degree, but I also feel that some things are sort of quite neutered in arts. Like, you, of course, I want my work to be much more kind of, you know, have a greater effect, but sometimes I do feel, you know, whatever I show, it sort of still gets put most of the time in the realm where, you know, people come as willing masochists if it's a sadistic act, you know. So that there is something that I feel that I just would never want to rest on something that I feel that I discovered, and perhaps that's why I keep changing the way I work, because it's almost like trying another method. Maybe at some point it becomes really sort of, you know, sadistic. Which is funny, because the piece that I made in the museum, Empty the Pond to Get the Fish, I made it and I sort of thought, this is the most cold-blooded work I've ever made. It's kind of got no heart. But maybe that's where we are right now.
Can you talk about how you use close-ups, especially in the last film?
Uh-huh. For me, I said that at the beginning, the idea of the close-up being actually something like a sort of, you know, it is like the jewel in cinema. And it's interesting, there's a text, I totally forgot who it's by, but Jacques Aumont, who talked about the close-up as something that used to be sort of so disembodying that in the beginning they thought it was monstrous and just couldn't understand. So every image used to be very much like the frame, you know, like in everything in scale. And it was only like 5 years later that they understood that the close-up is like the sort of way into the soul. And for me, the close-up in First Day of Spring was really about sort of giving the close-up in a true sense to people that you just don't look at, which can also, you know, like have its criticisms because there's nothing sort of completely redeeming about this work, but there's an attempt, you know. So the idea that when I've been to Bangladesh, it's incredible how most people you just see in a kind of flux, you know, and especially rickshaw pullers, who are like the most visible human labour, in the sense that their legs are like the sort of pistons in sort of a pre-industrial era or something. You just see the back of their heads. And you give them the money and you don't even really look at them, but maybe you do that with cab drivers. But there was just something, you know, in that gesture to use a zoom lens and to, not a zoom lens, but to use a sort of telephoto lens and really give that point of view to those people just in the way maybe even, you know, previously I pointed the camera at things you otherwise wouldn't look at. So the close-up of the face, I guess, for me, is also can be equalized to the close-up of anything, really. If there's no more questions, we could wrap it up. Thank you very much for coming.